in UK legislation as well.
Many thanks. And that concludes portfolio questions, and we now move to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 15356 in the name of Patrick Harvey on jobs and Scotland's new economy. I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And Mr Harvey, if you are ready to go, I would call on you to speak to and move the motion. You have 14 minutes, please.
I'm grateful, Presiding Officer, for the opportunity to bring this debate to the Chamber, and I move a motion 15356. In so doing, I'm sure that I can do that with confidence that the Chamber will respond to this debate with rather more seriousness than those in the media who have already, perhaps predictably, chosen to take absurd misquotes and an attempt to misrepresent the Green position on this issue. Nobody will take the issue of job losses in the North East trivially. It's a serious matter that impacts on communities in that region and on our wider economy. Even those of us who have long argued that we are over-reliant on the fossil fuel industries would never argue that the impact of job losses on this scale is something trivial. But simply to point out that comparing one headline, oil sector has lost 65,000 jobs, with another, oil and gas production rises for the first time in 15 years. This in alone is enough to demonstrate that the mantra of maximum economic extraction is not the same as securing maximum economic benefit for our society, or does it guarantee the security and safety of jobs in that industry or the wider economy? Many will recognise the context in which the current situation has taken place. Low oil prices do bear a great connection to wider geopolitical factors, the behaviour of Saudi Arabia and others, as well as the long-term decline in North Sea production, something which I hope none of us are in denial about any longer. The notion that the North Sea will get back to the levels of production it once had is not something that's credible. And the over-reliance on fossil fuels throughout our society and our economy, not just for energy, but for a wide range of other economic and industrial activities. But there are additional aspects to this context, aspects which will, in my view, require us to face up to the long-term transition which is required and a necessary move toward embracing the change which that transition will bring about. First of all, the carbon bubble. This is an argument set out in the IPCC's fifth assessment report, which was the first to include an assessment of the overall carbon budget of the planet. At some estimates, something like 1,000 billion tonnes of carbon dioxide emissions or equivalent, to give us a likely chance of achieving that 2-degree threshold, not allowing climate change to exceed 2 degrees above pre-industrial levels. And by 2011, it was estimated that more than half of that budget had already been emitted. So depending on the varieties of interpretation, somewhere between 446 and 616 billion tonnes left to emit if we want to have that reasonable likelihood of restraining climate change. But other estimates put this even more starkly. If we look at the additional warming factors from the way in which carbon dioxide is emitted, some estimates put this down to as little as 270 billion tonnes left in the global budget. Now, this is dramatically at odds with the level of fossil fuel reserves existing on the planet. We already know that we have far more fossil fuel than we can afford to burn if we're remotely serious about achieving that likelihood. And this is not an argument that only comes from the IPCC. I hope the Minister is still able to hear me. This is not only an argument that comes from the IPCC, the global intergovernmental body advising all of us. It's certainly not an argument that only comes from environmentalists and campaigners. Just recently, just a few months ago indeed, Mark Carney, the Governor of the Bank of England, made much the same argument. speaking, again, not to campaigners, not to activists, but to financiers in the City of London, he warned of the financial stability risk that this country faces given our massive overexposure to the carbon bubble. This is an industry profoundly overvalued because its values are based on the assumption that all of those reserves will be turned into economic resources, will be effectively put onto the global market and burned. The budget amounts to between one-fifth and one-third of the world's proven reserves of oil, gas and coal, said Mark Carney. If that estimate is even approximately correct, it would render the vast majority of reserves stranded, literally unburnable, which itself alters fossil fuel economics. Now, this is a case that I've put to the Scottish Government on a number of occasions, and one previous minister, the last climate change minister, appeared to understand. In October 2013, I asked about that IPCC report and the growing consensus on the carbon bubble. He answered, "I don't have a figure to give, Mr. Harvey, for the percentage of fossil fuels that I would like to see remain under the earth, but I accept the point that if we were to burn all the fossil fuels in the world, we would be doing untold damage." Sadly, Scotland's energy minister has repeatedly failed to endorse this basic argument. And all of this comes, of course, before the most recent development in context, which is the Paris Agreement, because that carbon budget in the IPCC's fifth assessment report is based on the 2-degree target, the idea of keeping climate change to a limit of 2 degrees above pre-industrial levels. Well, the Paris Agreement goes further. It notes with concern the estimated aggregate greenhouse gas emissions in 2025 and 2030 resulting from intended nationally determined contributions and says they do not fall within at least 2 degree C scenarios. It then goes on to say that there should be a goal of achieving global temperature increase well below 2 degrees C and even going on to a 1.5 degree target. That dramatically shrinks even further the global carbon budget and poses a challenge to all fossil fuel producing countries to recognise that those resources are not a value to our economy, they are a vulnerability. And I give way to the Minister.
Minister Ferguson.
Does he accept that carbon capture and storage is a technology which is necessary to achieve the objectives that he describes? And will he join us in condemning the UK government's decision to withdraw support for the Shell SSE project that we were all looking forward to going ahead at Peterhead and making just such a contribution to climate change?
Sir Harvey?
I have certainly condemned the decision to scrap the funding for that scheme. I've done so in debates when the Minister was present before, but I do so in the context of recognising that research on CCS will tell us whether or not it's something that we can come to rely on in future. At the moment, it is not a technology which will work out of the box, not something that we can rely on. Even if that funding was in place, we would still need to find out whether it's something that can play a role. Now, there will be those who will pretend that Greens and others don't care about the job losses involved, don't care about the communities currently over-dependent on fossil fuel industries. Nothing could be further from the truth. We're the ones setting out the case for Scotland to move away from an agenda which is not only polluting, not only destructive to our environmental life support system, the system that we all depend on for our survival, not only incompatible with the IPCC's budget, but fundamentally short-lived. The word unsustainable is not jargon, it means it cannot last. And because it will not last, we need to be investing in the alternatives that will. And I give way to Mr. Brodie.
Will Mr. Harvey accept that, as per the University of Dundee report on climate change, that Scotland, in fact, is leading way, is top of the European League for emission reductions? Based on 2011 data, emissions in Scotland fell by 29.6%. The European average is 17.1%. So what can we do to ensure that at least that kind of message is being given?
Jack Harvey.
Well, I think a great deal has been done by Scottish ministers and many of us to welcome and congratulate the consensus on the setting of targets. Not enough has been done on the reaching of those targets. But the point I am making is not about our tailpipe emissions. It's about the carbon we're digging out of the ground and pumping out from under the sea. Whether that ends up on Scotland's emissions inventory or somebody else's, you take that fossil carbon out of the ground and it will end up in the atmosphere. And that's the responsibility that fossil fuel producing countries are going to have to acknowledge. I don't believe any have yet. So we are setting out the case that these changes are not only desirable, not only inevitable, but they're already upon us. And those countries which deny that reality will fail to realise the positive opportunities that this change brings about. Already, there are those bidding for oil and gas decommissioning jobs in Scotland, and they're up against competition from other countries. Well, if we allow others to develop the reputation globally, as well as the skill set to undertake that decommissioning work, we'll be left behind in the race to build that alternative industry. Scotland's been here already. We've been here before. Let's not go there again, seeing an economic change, an industrial change coming down the line and failing to be ready to adapt to it, leaving communities stranded as a result. I want to mention the... I'll take a, one further intervention.
Bruce Crawford.
Patrick Harvey would agree with me that if this decommissioning process accelerates too much and the oil price recovers... billion barrels left in the North Sea, there's the potential we'll lose a lot of the skills that are involved in the North Sea and not be able to become re-engaged when the time comes to make sure we can exploit what's already there.
Recovery does nothing to change the fundamental context of the world's global carbon budget and the overvaluation of this industry. We will still be over-reliant on an industry that's overvalued. That's an economic bubble, not just an environmental problem. And we all know what happens when economic bubbles burst. How reliant do we want to be on that when that moment comes? I want to mention the STUC's warning as well in giving evidence to the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee just recently in our short inquiry into the oil and gas industry. We were told even if we took climate change right out of the equation and focused on the change in the economics of the oil industry, you would still have to be looking toward the transition happening much earlier than was previously anticipated. And later we were told we have to be planning for the North Sea to have a shorter lifespan than previously thought. This isn't a question of whether you share the view that this is a desirable change. This change is upon us, and we must be ready, we must be prepared, and we must be investing in the alternative. So there is the opportunity for us not only to get back on track with our own carbon emissions, making up the lost ground of 10 million extra tonnes of CO2 that we put into the atmosphere given the missed targets, something that I hope we can do despite the reduction in funding in the current Scottish budget for both climate change and energy efficiency in particular, which are being cut by 10% and 13% respectively. If we reverse that in the budget, we do have the opportunity to get back on track with that climate change agenda. But we must also open up the opportunity for transition. Look at the opportunity for the new industries which will emerge, not only in energy production, clean, green, renewable energy production, not only in decommissioning, but in other sustainable industries, whether that's the retrofit job that has to be done on our built environment and the huge number of jobs that can come out of that agenda, or indeed the development of new science. No one can tell me, no one can convince me that Scotland doesn't have what it takes to put in some of the research effort that the world is going to have to undertake to find alternative chemical feedstocks when those hydrocarbons are no longer available. There will be a period when they're too valuable to burn, but we're not going to be able to pretend that they will continue flowing forever. In closing, Deputy Presiding Officer, I want to argue that ministers of any political party have been at their best in this Parliament when they're under pressure from a Parliament which is bold enough to push them to go further. Whether that's on the fracking moratorium, which I'm sure Mr Ewing was delighted to have to announce, whether it's on community ownership, whether it's on climate change, and Greens have a strong track record of pushing the government beyond its own comfort zone. But Greens are also the only political party willing to acknowledge that Scotland requires requires this transition away from over-reliance on fossil fuels and setting out the opportunities for how this can be a beneficial transition, one that's good for our society, good for our economy, as well as bringing us into line with the ecological limits that the planet sets down. With a bolder Parliament, Scotland can make this change and we can make it a better change for everyone.
Thanks. Very tight for time today. I now call on Fergus Ewing to speak to and move Amendment 15356.2. Mr Ewing, 10 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome this debate as an opportunity to highlight the importance of the energy sector to Scotland. It's important to realise that Scotland has an abundance of energy resources, including oil, gas, wind, hydro, wave and tidal. And this affords us the opportunity to develop a rich and diverse energy mix that is both resilient and secure. The twin Scottish Government objectives of developing a low-carbon economy and ensuring good stewardship of our oil and gas resources are both extremely important to the economic well-being of our nation. Presiding Officer, the oil and gas industry in Scotland has achieved great things in its first half century. And it's very important that we recognise the enormous asset it's been to Scotland and the huge contribution that workers within that industry have provided. But it is no exaggeration to say that now, in January 2016, it faces the most severe challenges. What is required from us all in this place, and all who have any position of power or responsibility, is to respond positively and do everything of practical benefit that we can to help the industry through these difficult times. That applies to the Scottish Government, every MSP, the UK Government, local government, banks and industry, the workforce and trade unions. It applies to us all. Sir Ian Wood said just last week, we must not panic. There are, Presiding Officer, a huge number of successes. Production, in fact, is rising. Projects, contracts and developments are being progressed and being progressed well. Each day we read of these in the Press and Journal in particular and publications like Scottish Energy News. We have many new or newly refurbished fields coming into production, such as the BP's Clare Field, Quad, ETAP, Statoil's Mariner Field, Maersk's Culzean, EnQuest, Kraken, and many, many more. So, Presiding Officer, merchants of doom peddle false wares. Equally, we have a unique opportunity in Scotland where the expertise gained from half a century of exploitation of oil and gas in the waters around our country gives a particular advantage in the development of renewable technology. Countries such as Norway, Sweden, Denmark show that there is no contradiction between making use of substantial, in the case of Denmark, gas reserves, whilst leading the transition to a low-carbon economy. It's the energy expertise from oil and gas which often can help in renewables, as evidenced by many companies working in Scotland who are involved in both sectors. A good example, Presiding Officer, I believe, is Statoil. Not only is it developing the new Mariner field, but it is also developing the world's largest floating offshore wind development, a very exciting one in my view, and one enabled by decisions taken by the Scottish Government. I've just returned from a two-day visit to Caithness, where I visited Scrabster Harbour. I heard how their new facilities, part funded by HIE, have served the oil industry with 500,000 tonnes of goods over the year, as well as renewables. So Scrabster is well placed to serve west of Shetland fields such as Clare, such as the Total fields of Laggan or Tormore, or the new Premier Solan field coming on stream shortly. But it also plays a part in renewables because it's just near Magen, just along the coast, which is going to be the world's largest commercial tidal array. I also visited JGC Engineering just in Janetstown, up the road from Scrabster, a quality and growing engineering company whose work spans both oil and gas and renewables. The company has just produced a large number of 200-ton ballast blocks for the Magen project, whose onshore facility I visited on Monday. The point I'm making is a very simple one, Presiding Officer. Many, many companies many ports and harbours, many, many people are engaged in work where oil and gas and renewables go hand in hand. Expertise in one area lends itself to a gaining success in the other. But the low, well, all right.
Harvey?
I'm grateful to the Minister, and he's quite right, of course, that there are skills which can be transferred across into new industries. But the question I've put out most centrally is, for how long can these go hand in hand? Will the Minister acknowledge the central argument that the world has far more fossil fuel reserves than we can afford to burn, and tell us what proportion he thinks is responsible for a country like Scotland to extract in the future?
Well, there are several questions there, but let me say that without all of us supporting the work that companies in Scotland do right now, in 2016 and for the foreseeable future, then we won't see companies go into transition. We'll see companies go into administration, because that's what happens if the green recipe is adopted. Now, let me carry on, Presiding Officer. The low oil price shows no sign of abating, and many believe that it will remain lower for longer. Most believe that the price will, however, recover in due course. The question is, what can be done? Now, I'm wholly convinced that political point scoring is just not what is wanted. The people who work in the industry, people who are facing redundancy, what they want from us and what is required from us all is a variety of different support. First of all, support the work they do in a clear and unqualified way. Value the work that they do. Recognise that it is of the highest order. Second, to recognise that industry itself has the primary challenge of reducing costs and increasing efficiency. The industry will recognise this. Ask any company, they will say so. To listen, heed, learn from use and gains from the supply chain. Melford Campbell of the Oil and Gas Industry Leadership Group, which we co-chair, profoundly believes that the supply chain have enormous amounts to contribute that perhaps has not been heeded properly in the past. Progress has been made in cost reduction. The challenge is to do so without jeopardising safety, which must remain paramount. Third, at the Oil and Gas Day, which I attended in London last December with industry, the OGA and the UK government, I asked that specifically we listen and learn to the workforce. NextGen adopted a practice of going out to the workforce, asking what they thought could be done to improve matters. They came back with many, many measures, techniques, changes to working practices. Many were adopted. They increased wrench time, that's productive time, in a shift offshore enormously. By listening to the workforce, we can help improve things together. The STUC's role is invaluable there too. Fourthly, the Scottish Government must continue to play its part. We have created the Energy Jobs Task Force announced by the First Minister last January. I could talk in detail about that work, but we are determined to carry on that work and ensure that it is supplemented where necessary in every possible way that will bring practical benefit to individuals who face redundancy. Well, no, I'm sorry, I've got little time left. Fifthly, we do need to ensure that we defer cessation of production, we extend late life assets fields, and there are some practical measures that the UK government, I believe, must do, principle of which is to sort out the lack of clarity on liability for decommissioning costs. The reason for that, Presiding Officer, is that that lack of clarity is stalling and preventing deals being done which would bring in new investment to the North Sea. This was the major point that was raised with me by several companies and operators in my most recent visit to Aberdeen a couple of weeks ago. Finally, we must have measures from the UK government which address and improve the tax deal for the industry. We do need more support for exploration. We need them again to look at tax rates. We need to look at extending the investment allowance to enable late life fields to continue their work. And lastly, we need to continue the good work that we're doing in respect of decommissioning. We in the Scottish Government, through our economic development agencies, have worked closely with many players here, have done a great amount of work. And I can cite as one example the work that's taking place in Lerwick with the partnership between the Lerwick Port Authority and Peterson SPS, a major company in the field. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I believe it's in all our interests to have both a thriving and successful oil and gas industry which navigates these most severe challenges, but also, going forward, a thriving and successful renewables sector. And I believe that as the Energy Minister over the last 5 years, that we have made considerable efforts to achieve both objectives, and we will certainly continue so to do.
Many thanks. And I now call on Murdo Fraser to speak to and move Amendment 15356.2.1 to Amendment 15356.2 in the name of Fergus Ewing. Mr Fraser, you have 6 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start by welcoming the opportunity presented to us this afternoon by the Independent and Green Group for a debate on North Sea oil and gas. It's indeed a very well-timed debate. Only on Monday, the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee produced its report on future prospects for oil and gas in Scotland. And Patrick Harvey, of course, sits on that committee. And to be fair to him, he did dissent from four of the committee's recommendations in that report. I noticed he was in the press yesterday describing the report's conclusions as reckless, which I think is rather unfortunate language to use from a report that was supported by all other members of the committee, all other parties represented, a report which is, in my view, measured and balanced, and a report which has been warmly welcomed by those in the sector and those whose jobs depend upon the industry. And the fact that this debate is timely is probably the kindest thing I can say about Mr Harvey's motion this afternoon, for it is a remarkably downbeat, depressing view of a sector which is still of great importance to the Scottish economy. And the overwhelming view of the Economy, Enterprise and Tourism Committee was that, with the appropriate support from governments and enhanced collaboration, a sustainable industry can emerge from the existing downturn. Of course, it's not so long ago since we heard the Green Party banging on about peak oil. We don't need too long memories in this chamber to remember Mr Harvey and his colleagues telling us that oil production was at record high levels, that the oil was going to run out very soon, and that oil prices were on an endlessly upwards trajectory, and it would become an increasingly unaffordable commodity. And today, as we look at an oil price per barrel of just $28, these predictions have as much validity as those who said that the finances of an independent Scotland would be based on an oil price of $110 per barrel or more. So having got that spectacularly wrong, the Green Party has now changed its tune and is now saying that the decline in oil price means that there needs to be a transition away from fossil fuels towards a new economy. Yes, Mr Harvey can remind us everything he said about peak oil, if he wants.
I'm sure that Mr Fraser understands the reality of peak oil arguments, and they bear no relationship to his words a few moments ago. But will he at least acknowledge that our key argument, whether oil prices are high or low, is that burning all the stuff that we've got is simply incompatible with our own survival? Will he recognise that the context we're bringing forward is one of geology, not geopolitics and economics?
No. See, the fundamental problem with Mr Harvey's argument is that he assumes that the only use to which we put hydrocarbons is to burn them. There are many other uses to which we put hydrocarbons. We use them. If he visits the INEOS plant in Grangemouth, he will see that hydrocarbons are used as the raw material in the production of a whole range of products. There's hardly anything we use in the modern world that does not include some elements of hydrocarbons as a source material. So this is not just about having an industry to produce material we can burn. It's also about having an industry that produces material that provides essential components in virtually every area of modern life. Now, like other members of the Parliamentary Committee, I'm well aware of the decline in the sector, with some 65,000 jobs thought to have been lost so far, and new job losses being announced almost on a weekly basis. But we also know that the nature of the industry is cyclical. And if we look back at changes in oil price over the last 40 years, we see that prices go up and they go down. And while none of us can accurately predict the future, what we can do is expect that there will be a recovery sooner or later. There will be an industry to support in coming decades. And what our role today is to ensure that the industry gets the support it needs in the interim. So there are three areas where I believe action is required. The first is in driving out cost inefficiencies, where already the industry is taking action, and undoubtedly the low price is a driver to making this happen more quickly than otherwise would be the case. The second is in relation to tax. The industry was very pleased with the changes brought in by the Chancellor in the budget last year. And while there's always room for more changes to be considered, and I know that the Chancellor will be considering these in the run-up to the budget this year, the evidence suggests that further tax changes are not in fact high on the list of industry demands at the present time. And thirdly, no, I need to make some progress, so Mr McDonald will forgive me. But if he checks the evidence given to the committee, he'll see that that was the case in terms of the evidence we heard. And thirdly, there is the question of regulatory changes being driven through by the Oil and Gas Authority, still a relatively new body and one which is winning industry respect. All these things are necessary to ensure that we have a viable industry for the foreseeable future. But they do not avoid the fact that we do have a downturn, which might last several years or more, and those who have lost their jobs do need support in helping to find alternative employment. And here I do have some sympathy for the notion of a transition to the new economy. And our amendment this afternoon makes specific reference to some of the opportunities which are available. The Beatrice Offshore Wind Farm, a 588-megawatt scheme in the Murray Firth, is expected to commence commercial operations in 2018-2019, backed by an early investment deal under the Contract for Difference programme from the UK government. This 110-turbine scheme could create up to 5,000 jobs. Along with other Mid-Scotland and five members in the Chamber, I've been backing Burnt Island Fabrications as a bidder for the contracts for installing these offshore turbines from SSE. Byfab are an important local employer in Fife, which has seen significant contraction recently, and the opportunity from this contract could be of considerable value in securing jobs and creating new ones in the local area. No, I'm sorry, I don't have time for the Minister. Presiding officer, it's not just in offshore wind where we have the opportunity for low-carbon energy. The new nuclear power station at Hinkley Point C will provide some 20,000 jobs in the construction phase. And there are three Scottish companies, Doosan Babcock, SPX Clyde Union Pumps and Weir Group, who are preferred bidders for contracts worth more than £1.3 billion, potentially securing thousands of jobs in Scotland, utilising skills transferable in engineering from the oil and gas industry. Presiding officer, we cannot support the negative, backward-looking Green Party motion today. We are happy to support the Scottish Government's forward-looking amendment, arguing for a more balanced approach to energy provision and continued support for the oil and gas sector in the North Sea. And I have pleasure in moving the even more forward-looking amendment in my name. Thank you.
Thanks. I now call on Lewis MacDonald to speak to and move Amendment 15356.1. If you could confine yourself to 6 minutes, that would be a huge help, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Scotland faces an oil jobs crisis which demands an urgent and concerted response. And getting that response right should be the focus of our debate today. As we have heard, there are those who would abandon future production and rush to decommissioning in the North Sea. That would indeed increase the risk to the livelihoods of thousands of people in oil and gas and far beyond, and undermine the Scottish economy as a whole. There are also those who have claimed that there is no crisis, only a downturn in the economic cycle. A modest increase in production means that all is well and that the industry can be sure of a bright future. That is equally misguided. Neither collapse nor recovery is certain. What is certain is that those who understate the significance of the industry or the severity of the challenge are in danger of making the crisis worse. Production of oil and gas from the North Sea has rightly been described as one of the most important episodes in our economic history since 1945. And the oil and gas sector is undoubtedly one of the pillars of the modern Scottish economy. Before the current crisis, oil and gas accounted for 13% of Scottish GDP. Business won by Scottish oil service companies around the world generated billions of pounds of income to the Scottish economy, and the industry supported, directly or indirectly, well over 200,000 Scottish jobs. Whatever the future prospects of North Sea oil, it is not a bonus and it is not an optional extra. It is of critical importance to us all. And today it is under threat. Thousands of jobs have already gone. Last September, the industry's own estimate was that 65,000 jobs had been lost across the UK economy. And sadly, the tally of jobs lost continues to rise. In the few days that have passed since BP announced 600 job losses in the North Sea, another 500 redundancies have been announced or confirmed by Sparrows Group, ConocoPhillips, Enermec and Petrofac. Wood Group has said it is moving office jobs from Aberdeen to India. And AMEC has announced that it will cut the pay of offshore and onshore contractors by 7.5%. Every job cut or pay cut in the oil and gas sector in and around Aberdeen has a knock-on effect. Every part of the local economy takes a hit, from the travel agents who also announced redundancies in the city yesterday to the fast food vans selling to workers at the factory gate. And those still in jobs are affected too. Fewer people having to do more work is bad enough for workers onshore. Workers offshore worry about fatigue and stress when they are asked to go from 2 weeks on the platform to three, and wonder whether the cost pressure on employers will affect the safe operation of the platform itself. And the impact on the wider economy reaches far beyond the North East, from island communities where earnings from working offshore are combined with part-time agriculture, to steel plants and engineering firms in West Central Scotland facing the very real threat of closure. The Federation of Small Businesses this week reported that Scottish smaller business confidence has fallen to its lowest level in 3 years, and the gap between Scotland and the rest of the UK is widening. So we cannot discuss the oil jobs crisis or a transition to a low-carbon economy as if they were abstract issues. This is about working people who have lost their jobs, communities under pressure, businesses facing closure. The oil jobs crisis is a reality of life right now for thousands of people across Scotland. Claudia Beamish and other colleagues will say more from this side about how to achieve a just transition to a low-carbon future. But others must also recognise that the transition driven by crisis and dislocation would be anything but just. All the more reason, therefore, why the Scottish Government must carry out an urgent and detailed assessment of the impact of the current low oil price on the strength and stability of the Scottish economy itself, as we call for in our amendment. Setting up a task force to help workers made redundant is, of course, welcome, but on its own it is not enough. When one of the pillars of the Scottish economy is trembling, the first thing that Scotland's devolved government should do is to assess the nature and scale of the risk that we face. Either ministers have not yet done that, or they have carried out that assessment but chosen not to publish the results. Ministers surely have a duty to measure and to report on the scale of the challenge so that their own enterprise agencies, local councils and other partners have the information on which to act.
Yeah, Brody.
Thank you for taking the intervention. I think we share the short-term concerns about the industry. I wonder if Mr MacDonald can give us some view on why production of North Sea oil actually rose last year.
Well, very, very short and simple answer is that the companies under the immense pressure of the low oil price have finally begun to address the issues of efficiency that they have failed to address in past years. So I hope the Scottish Government will give support to the Oil and Gas Authority as the regulator charged with changing the culture of the UK oil and gas industry towards that greater cooperation, and to encourage it as well to continue to share risk in extending the life of key infrastructure offshore, as was done with the investment in exploration in the last few months. Ministers should support the transfer of knowledge, skills and technologies from production to decommissioning and the big new opportunities such as offshore wind, but they should do that in the context of maximising economic recovery of oil rather than closing it down. And they should carry forward the work of planning jobs where jobs in Scotland will come from for future generations without throwing away the jobs and business we have here today. Thank you very much.
Many thanks for your brevity. And we now move to the open debate, and I call on Mark MacDonald to be followed by Leslie Brennan. No time in hand at all today, so up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And as a member representing a constituency in Aberdeen, clearly today's debate is of extreme importance to the area I represent and to my constituents, many of whom are facing an uncertain future as a result of the oil price downturn. And I think one of the challenges that is always faced in politics is to address the seriousness of the issue while at the same time avoiding talking the future prospects of the industry down, because we've seen a number of commentators speak of the fact that there is still a long-term future in terms of both exploration and production. It's a question of how the industry is supported during the current period, not a question of casting it adrift. And I think that is the balancing act that needs to be performed when we discuss this. But to deal with the issue that Patrick Harvey and the Greens have brought to the Chamber today around the transition, because to listen to what is being said and to some of the commentary previously, it would be easy to assume that support for renewables is not in place, that there is not work being done and leadership being shown by the Scottish Government in relation to renewables. But if we look at the briefing sent to members by Scottish Renewables themselves, they speak of the leadership of the Scottish Government and cross-party political support, setting strong objectives to the renewable sector, leading to thousands of jobs and attracting finance from across the globe. Perhaps in just a second, Mr Harvey. It talks of renewables now being our largest generator of power, renewable heat quadrupling from 2009 to 2014. So that, to me, demonstrates a strong performance in relation to renewables. Indeed, renewables overtook nuclear in 2014 as Scotland's single largest source of electricity. We also, in September of 2015, reached the target for 500 megawatts of community and local owned renewables. That was a target that was set for 2020, not 2015. So that target was hit 5 years early. So there is leadership, there is support, and the work is being done to ensure the renewable sector can thrive. But there are impediments in place, which I'll come to after I take Mr Harvey's intervention.
I'm grateful to Mr MacDonald for giving way. And I welcome the progress that's been made on renewable electricity, much less progress so far on renewable in the rest of the energy system. But it is clear that generating more renewable electricity in itself doesn't cut emissions unless it displaces fossil fuels. And if we continue to extract those fossil fuels, then whether they end up being used in Scotland or anywhere else, the fossil carbon ends up in the atmosphere.
See, this is where Mr Harvey and I depart, is when he creates the either-or situation that he is seeking to create here. We have to have appropriate management of our resources because we will require those hydrocarbons in the near future. We cannot simply get to that stage that Mr Harvey seeks to get to by simply switching off support and allowing the industry to decline further. What I will say is that there are impediments in place in relation to renewables, and the Scottish Renewables briefing goes into some detail of those. They exist in terms of the policy changes that are taking effect at a Westminster level in relation to the energy policy approaches that are being taken there, which are making it harder for renewable companies to invest, to attract finance and to operate. Those are the changes that need to be made and need to be effected if we want to see that support, that welcome support for the renewable sector, continue to increase in Scotland. There's another point here around the oil and gas sector and where support is required. And I heard the comments that Murdo Fraser made around there not being support around further tax issues, to further tax changes. It's quite clear that there is a requirement for tax changes in relation to exploration to try and stimulate and boost exploration activity. That would have two effects. Firstly, it would allow for safeguarding of jobs. It would allow for the activity to increase and also for support to go into the supply chain. I spoke to a supply chain company in the North East recently who said that if rigs were out active and exploring at present, that would be worth around £250,000 per rig to that company. So four exploration rigs for that company would equate to £1 million. That is a very stark contrast with the zero that they get while those rigs sit idle. So exploration activity being boosted has a direct effect not just on those individuals who are employed and those companies who are employed in that exploration activity, but further down the supply chain as well. There are massive benefits that could be realised in the short term, and that would support those who are currently being affected as a result of the downturn. But also the other issue around why exploration activity and stimulation of exploration activity is important is because it allows for the industry to be in a position to be able to hit the ground running when price recovers, rather than to have to then undertake that exploration activity to then reap the yield that comes from it. Exploration tax credits in Norway in the mid-2000s proved to be a significant success, led to some substantial discoveries, and at the point at which the oil price recovered in the mid-2000s, mid to late 2000s, Norway was in a position to capitalise upon that very early. I believe that the same opportunities can be realised for the oil and gas industry were those tax credits to be put in place. I think it's a plea that the industry should be making, and many in the industry are making, many experts are making, and I believe the Scottish Government is making. I think we should unite to make those pleas to the Chancellor for the budget that those changes can be effected.
Many thanks. I now call on Leslie Brennan to be followed by Chick Brody. Members will wish to note that this is Leslie Brennan's first speech in our Parliament. Ms Brennan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I begin by thanking you and the other members across all the parties and the parliamentary staff for the warm welcome I've received since coming here rather unexpectedly. And I thank the Green and Independent Group for this opportunity to discuss jobs in Scotland's new economy, especially as my first academic job was in the fields of environmental economics. And then University of Aberdeen in Dundee, and I also taught ecological economics during my time at Dundee University. So this is something that I'm really interested in. Before discussing the topic in hand, I wish to pay tribute to my predecessor, Richard Baker, who worked hard for the people of the North East, and he was known across the chamber as a sincere and compassionate person. Richard was a strong voice and a very willing and active participant in this chamber. And these attributes that Richard has will stand Age Scotland in good stead, as he's a really good guy and to have back on their team. Yeah. So returning to the motion, at the heart of the motion is the economy. And no one would disagree that the Scottish economy is currently weak. The Scottish Government's latest figure for growth is 0.1%. Research published today from the Resolution Foundation reinforces this, the fragility in the labour market in Scotland. Looking forward, there are very few glimmers of hope on the horizon, with the massive cuts to local authorities due to the settlement from the Scottish Government and the devastation in the oil and gas industry. This sharp contraction in the oil and gas sector is devastating for the thousands of workers and their families, particularly in Aberdeen and the rest of the North East. With another hat on, I'm a local councillor in Dundee. And we've had, not just in Dundee, but I know with colleagues up in Aberdeen, people who have been made redundant from the oil and gas sector and then coming to become taxi drivers. So you've got skilled workers and suddenly then they're trying to... And obviously the difference in that income is having a huge impact on obviously themselves, their families and their local communities. So we've got that contraction in the economy. And then on top of this, COSLA is forecasting 15,000 job losses due to the local government settlement. So the full effect of these on local businesses in Scotland should not be underestimated. Because of this, there is a real risk of contagion spreading throughout the Scottish economy. So action is needed now. The other component of this debate that needs urgent attention is the environment. Our environment is a precious system full of linkages and interdependencies. Our environment cannot be replaced when lost. The scientific evidence for climate change is overwhelming, as is the role of humans in speeding up the changes. The pace of climate change needs to reduce. Where possible, reversed. All organisations need to implement change. So we have a role here in Parliament, we're doing it for the Scottish Government. We're obviously making sure that whether it's households or private businesses, that they implement these changes. So it was disappointing to read today that a survey of 1,400 CEOs from across the world compiled by PricewaterhouseCoopers suggests that climate change fails to top the list of threats for business leaders at Davos. However, I suppose at least 50% of these CEOs did say it is a key threat to their business about climate change. Some businesses can reduce their carbon footprint and their costs to improve sort of work-life balance for their employees by encouraging working from home. I was previously a home worker and I know the benefits this can bring. But also it's about networks as well. I remember on one project I worked in virtual meetings, I was in Dundee, colleagues were in London, there was another colleague in Baltimore in America, and another colleague in Santiago in Chile. So the carbon, if we all met in one location, would be massive, but actually being able to connect up. So that's one of the benefits of the sort of new, trying to diversify our economy and looking at the knowledge economy. But it is about, really about thinking back about the climate. We need to be changing our behaviour and be mindful that small changes can have a positive impact. So whether it's reusing, recycling or reducing our consumption. Scotland is making improvements on recycling rates, cutting emissions and making our air cleaner, but the official targets have been repeatedly missed. Deputy Presiding Officer, I believe the labour movement and the environmental movement are natural allies. Our goal is the same. We want a society that is run in our collective interests, in the interest of protecting our planet. There's been a lot of talk about creating a vibrant, low economy with green enterprise at its heart. But especially now with the following the agreement secured in Paris, the pace of change needs to increase in order to tackle climate change and to grow the economy. As Lord Stern stated, tackling climate change and growing the economy are not mutually exclusive. They're mutually dependent, and I couldn't agree more. So we need to ensure that tackling climate change is fully implemented and delivers jobs and the skills to do these new jobs. And I suppose that's where we are, making sure that there's enough capacity in the college sector. Jobs associated with tackling climate change range from, obviously, recently, about flood prevention, making sure that we've got that investment for flood prevention, improving efficiency, energy efficiency in homes and buildings, and to generate knowledge to improve renewable energy technologies. New jobs are needed, and they need to be delivered to boost our sluggish local and national economies. And with respect to Dundee, Mr Salmon did promise 700 renewable jobs, energy jobs, following the signing of the Memorandum of Understanding in December 2011. But sadly, these never appeared.
So in closing, Deputy
Presiding Officer, the people of Scotland want us to work together to find solutions and to implement them. I look forward to working with the people across the Chamber over the next 9 weeks to meet these challenges. Thank you again.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Now, Colin Chick-Brodie, to be followed by Liam MacArthur. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Presiding Officer. May I, in following that speech, congratulate Leslie on her first contribution. I'm sure there will be many others. I welcome the debate today, and I fully appreciate the intent and the feelings and the principles behind the Greens' motion today. But I have to say I feel that it is a bit reckless, but it takes those in a rush to invent a new narrative. Time and patience are required to make it credible. It sets aspirations, ultimately laudable aspirations, though it may seem to be devoid of meaningful analytical facts. It is therefore in danger of propelling its aims and objectives, creating an immediate element of fear as it pursues the aspiration, no matter how well-being that aspiration may be. The position is that the government is building a sustainable low-carbon economy, sustainable economically and environmentally. The position is clear. The oil industry, though current times are difficult, will recover. And I will come to that later, Presiding Officer. We are already three-quarters of the way towards meeting our goal of carbon emission targets. And we want over time, to develop a structured balance between our obligation to the environment, to the economy and to jobs, to the planet, and to recognise the achievable balance of natural resources and fossil fuels are required to meet not just the Scottish economy and jobs, but our contribution, indeed, to the global economy on both these fronts. The first point... No, time is very limited. The first point I would make is welcoming the Parish Initiative, is you cannot plan a transition away from Scotland's reliance on fossil fuels in the short term or in a period of huge global political volatility. Oil, petrochemical and hydrocarbons are indeed a major ingredient of day-to-day products, and therefore the need for downstream jobs across not just transport or domestic industrial energy, but ingredients, medical equipment, many drugs, domestic and industrial appliances, industries like retail are dependent upon input from hydrocarbons. So let's analyse the Greens' view of the oil industry in Scotland without fear or favour. The motion talks of job losses and dramatic oil price fluctuations. Now, I accept, Presiding Officer, that these are difficult times for the industry. But let's see what the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee, of which Mr Harvey is a member, said in its very recent short inquiry and report on the oil and gas industry. It said, our report is a snapshot in time. And I'll come back to that also. It also said that no one can predict with any certainty what the oil price will be in 12 months. We know that because of overproduction and sluggish demand in this very volatile global economy. Downward pressure on the oil market. But we have been here before. The price today, the price per barrel, is higher than it was in 2005 or indeed in parts of 2009. And the International Agency, only last week, in its very comprehensive oil price outlook report, considered all of the current and future international and global political and economic scenarios. And in its current economic scenario, it said that the price of oil would grow progressively to $150 a barrel by 2040. Or in the lowest scenario, it said that it might rise to $95 a barrel by 2040. In addition to that input, Presiding Officer, the SDUC in our inquiry recognised that oil prices will rebound to a level where investment and therefore jobs in the continental shelf looks much more attractive. It was right, however, of the motion to raise the concern that in the short term the skills base might be undermined, leading to constraints when higher investment returns. This has to be part of the overall equation. And when the motion says the SDUC commented that we have to be planning, quote, for the North Sea to have a shorter lifespan than previously thought, my riposte would be that we haven't even considered, as the Oil and Gas Authority said at the committee, and I would say this, wouldn't I, oil and gas off the west of Shetland, Rockall, the Atlantic margins, and indeed the Inner Clyde. A scale of employment currently is threatened, but I believe will recover quite substantially. Am I too cavalier with regard to oil and gas production? No. Do I dismiss the absolute need to consider all appropriate actions? I repeat, all appropriate actions to support the Paris objectives? No. But I do ask that we exercise proper and not unreasonable approaches to seek the balance of resources and our environmental objectives. And within that balance, oil in the North Sea and the West has and will have a very significant part to play in the future. Oil and gas production on the UK continental shelf, as I mentioned earlier, has increased for the first time in the past year. And yes, we want to secure a sustainable environmental economy for the workers of today and the future. But facts like these have to be considered in any long-term plan. Presiding Officer, action is being taken. Inherent action. Part of its achievement, no doubt, due to some pressures such as those from the Greens. Recognise that. From the renewable targets and emissions. There is already a focus, I believe, on what the Greens seek, but that is part of an inherent strategy. Some might say it's part of an unwritten plan.
Many thanks. I now call Liam MacArthur to be followed by Sandra White and advise the Chamber we're incredibly tight for time.
Thanks very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I too warmly congratulate Leslie Brennan on her maiden speech? It's difficult enough becoming an MSP, but when it comes out of the blue as it has, I think it must be all the more difficult. And also, I think wish Richard Baker all the best in his new post. I welcome the opportunity to make a brief contribution and congratulate Patrick Harvey and his colleagues on bringing this debate to the Chamber. It is unfortunate, however, that the first debate on oil and gas in almost a year is based on the premise that is unambiguous in calling for an acceleration of the sector's demise. Those working in the sector across Scotland, those who may have recently lost their jobs, and indeed the wider public, who realise the continued importance of oil and gas production to our economy, will form their own views on the Green Party's motion. Yet they will also rightly ask why it is the Scottish Government appears to have been so reluctant for so long to debate the issues facing the sector. One statement last September is scant reflection either of the sector's importance or the scale of the challenges it faces. those facing the threat of losing their jobs, and indeed those who have already lost them, need to hear ministers and this Parliament voicing our support, our confidence in the future of this sector, as they have, I think, this afternoon. Fergus Ewing, I think, deserves genuine credit for his efforts, but at times it does seem as if he's been ploughing a lonely ministerial furrow. When the oil price first started plummeting, it was striking how long it took the newly installed First Minister to visit Aberdeen to meet with industry representatives. This reticence did not go unnoticed, and comparisons were inevitably made with the likely reaction of her predecessor. In the face of what no one now disputes is a crisis facing the oil and gas sector, the First Minister's failure to meet with the head of her Energy Jobs Task Force in over 6 months is astonishing, all the more so given what has happened to oil prices, jobs and confidence over that period. In his more private moments, I suspect the Energy Minister agrees. And this is part of a pattern. Just over a year ago, there was a similar reluctance from the Scottish Government to give this Parliament a chance to properly debate the future of the wave sector amidst an almost existential crisis. This is not good enough. Yes, opposition parties can bring forward motions, but parliamentary time is dominated by the government. And there are no lack of issues to debate. Yes, we need to develop a strategy for how we transition to a low-carbon economy. Oil and gas is a finite resource, and I have no difficulty in acknowledging that some of the resource will need to be left in the ground. I agree with Scottish Renewables that our chances of achieving our goals are not helped by a UK Tory government apparently hell-bent on dismantling much of the good work done under the previous coalition government, including in relation to CCR. Moreover, I firmly believe that many of the technical and engineering solutions being sought by the marine energy sector, for example, are to be found within the oil and gas supply chain. However, I also firmly believe that Sir Ian Wood is right when he cautions against panic reactions or premature decisions to decommission assets. Whatever our renewables future, and I'm still confident that it is a bright one, oil and gas will remain an integral part of our energy mix for decades to come. So rather than heed the counsel of those who are intent on shutting the sector down forthwith, we need to seriously look at what can be done to support the sector and those within it at this difficult time. The tax regime appears now more broadly supportive, with recent investment allowances viewed positively by those I have spoken to in the sector. Questions about removing, for example, the supplementary charge remain and should be kept under consideration. Similarly, with the energy bill going through Westminster at present, there is an opportunity to invest the Oil and Gas Authority with the powers and resources it needs to continue making a positive difference. For this, as I'm sure Fergus Ewing would agree, my Liberal Democrat colleague and former Energy Secretary Ed Davey deserves credit. His foresight in paving the way for the OGA by establishing Sir Ian Wood's review, I think, is worthy of acknowledgement. No one can have predicted back then what would happen to oil prices, but without that preparatory work, the situation would be immeasurably worse. Even before the passing of the energy bill, the OGA is having an effect. It's approving the evidence upon which government decisions are taken. It's already invested in seismic studies to the benefit of the sector, and looking ahead, the OGA will help ensure companies are not sitting on licences they're not using.
Apologies, Mr McArthur, it was not your final minute. I haven't cut speeches to 5 minutes just yet.
Right. With new sanctions and powers to access company data, the OGA will also have scope to challenge individual businesses on performance, helping improve the overall efficiency of the sector. And many of the solutions can only come from within the sector. Each business will be looking carefully and seriously at their own cost structures and seeing where efficiencies can be made. This, of course, cannot, absolutely must not, come at the expense of safety. More joint learning, I think, is also essential. To help this, I think the Scottish Government can be doing more. Having set up the Energy Skills Task Force, we need to see this work moving ahead with some urgency. Its conclusions undoubtedly will be helpful in feeding in to the coherent economic and energy strategy referred to in Lewis MacDonald's amendment. But let me conclude where I started. This needs the First Minister to be more fully and actively engaged. Symbolically, as well as at a practical level, this matters. The reality is this is a sector that touches most parts of the country in terms of jobs and its contribution to our economy. It's a sector that remains a key part of our energy mix over the coming decades. And it is a sector, Deputy Presiding Officer, whose future, for the foreseeable, we need to help safeguard, not sabotage. For these reasons, and notwithstanding an overly self-congratulatory tone with regards to meeting climate change targets, we will be supporting the Government's amendment at decision time this evening.
Thank you very much. I now call Sandra White to be followed by John Wilson. Speeches of less than 6 minutes would be helpful.
First of all, Presiding Officer, can I apologise for my mobile phone going off earlier on? I assure you it won't happen again. And can I congratulate Leslie Brennan and her maiden speech and look forward to working with her also. Presiding Officer, thank you. I'd like to start by welcoming the motion put forward by the Greens and Independents. It certainly gives us an opportunity to discuss, as the motion states, jobs in Scotland's new economy. But I do think we have to be realistic, and I say this in the best way possible. It will not happen overnight. These jobs will not materialise overnight. And I think we have to be realistic and realise that. We must ensure that, obviously, the workforce is behind us. We speak to the workforce as well. We work alongside the workforce. But we also have to ensure that when we look at a new energy system fit for the future, the workforce from the oil and gas industry are, you know, spoken to, met with as well, and going to, you know, dialogue with them if we had actually to deliver the skills which will deliver a new renewable energy system for Scotland. So I think that's an important part that we really have to look at, and we're looking at planning and implementing, you know, a concentrated plan and vision for a much more renewable source of energy and ending our ending our reliance on fossil fuels. I'll give way.
John Finney.
Thank you. I'm grateful for the member taking an intervention in the point. Perhaps the member cited on the unwritten plan that Mr. Brodie referred to. What time frame are you considering is appropriate for the just transition to a low-carbon economy?
Sandra,
I haven't saw the plan that Mr. Brodie's talking about either, and perhaps you could answer the same question you asked me. I think it's something you really, as I said earlier when my first contribution, we need to speak to the workforce. We need to ensure that people are actually trained in the skills to go over to a different type of renewable energy. So, I mean, I'm not, having a crystal ball. I can't see into the future, but I would assume it wouldn't be in the too distant future. But I do think you have to be realistic and make sure that people work together and it's sustainable. And that's what I would say to Mr. Finney and others as well. We have to look to the future, yes, but we need to be realistic in that as well. Many have mentioned the economic argument, but for myself, it's not just an economic argument as far as I'm concerned. I think it is to build a more sustainable future and combat the effects of global warming. And I do believe that Scotland is making great progress towards that. And my colleague, Mark MacDonald, in his contribution, certainly cited many projects which are going ahead at the moment. And like my colleague, I do think that we have made positive steps in both recognising and combating climate change in recent years. And of course, more does need to be done. However, I do believe that the recent Paris climate change, which is mentioned in the Greens and Independents motion agreement, offers us hope for the future. I think it was a monumental task to get so many nations to sign up to the agreement, and I really do hope this will just be the start of that. I also hope that Scotland can lead the way in demonstrating what is possible and how to achieve it. Indeed, when the First Minister attended the COP21 Global Climate Summit in Paris, she spoke at the largest business-focused event held during COP21, where Scotland was praised for its actions by the head of the UN climate body, Christiana Figueres. The First Minister also spoke to the climate group, which Scotland became a member of, the Climate Group's Compact of States and Regions, an international reporting platform representing 12.5% of global GDP and more than 325 million people worldwide, which I think demonstrates the collective impact devolved state and regional governments can have in tackling climate change. And I do think these clearly demonstrate the Scottish Government's ambitions. And whilst, as I've said before, as have others, more needs to be done. I also think we should welcome these initiatives and build upon them, because it's only through these initiatives and the international collective action that we'll move forward together to a sustainable global future. And it's something that I think we also really need to remember. Also highlighted in this particular summit was that world records were also broken. Denmark set a new world record for wind production in 2014, 39.1% of its overall electricity from the clean energy source. Scotland was also mentioned as having had a massive year for renewables. Wind turbines alone provided along 1,279 megawatt hours of electricity to the national grid, enough to supply the electrical needs of 164% of Scottish households, or 3.96 million homes. And I think that's something that we can certainly be proud of.
Final
An important
minute.
Aspect of the Scottish Government's approach that I would like to highlight is its pioneering climate justice approach. Nobody's mentioned this one before, which puts people and human rights, which I think is really important as well, at the heart of our action on climate change and in supporting fair and sustainable global development. I thought I had more time, I don't, I'm sorry. I had hoped to solely look at the positives, which I have mentioned today. Scotland is a world leader in many new and innovative technologies, abundant natural resources. However, we are being held back because we can do more. And I was disappointed, it's been mentioned already, that the carbon capture plant was rejected, that funding for renewables have been cut. And I think this leads to a very strong argument for energy policy to devolve to Scotland. I would hope that we would all agree on this, and would the other opposition parties join along with us in petitioning the UK government to support the carbon capture plant and the devolution of energy policy. Basically, I think that's something we should be looking at. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I'm afraid we are already over time for this debate, so I would ask members later in the debate to review their speech notes for timings, please. I call John Wilson to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And firstly, I'd like to declare an interest as a member of Unite the Union. And I'd also like to welcome Leslie Brennan to the Chamber and look forward to her contributions at both committee and within this Chamber. I'd like to thank the members who have taken the time to read this motion and discuss the issues raised within the motion, particularly to the future of Scotland and to the planet. This motion highlights our commitment and our need to tackle our growing dependence on fossil fuels. As a country and as a planet, we cannot continue burning fossil fuels at the rate we are. There are two concerns in that regard. Firstly, climate change and global warming are happening around us. Just recently across the UK, we have seen drastic weather and flooding on mass scale, causing incredible and lasting damage to hundreds of homes. Flooding represents the greatest threat from climate change facing the UK. Flooding is a real and present danger, and we need only look at the recent weather conditions to see the scale of the damage and disruption it can cause to people's lives and their livelihoods. I doubt anyone in this chamber would deny that climate change is real, that it presents a threat to our livelihoods, and that we have, as a nation, a responsibility to tackle it however we can. Secondly, fossil fuels are a finite resource. They cannot and will not last forever. That is a simple fact, and one that must be addressed. To not do so and to continue our dependence on fossil fuels is dangerous and irresponsible. These are important points, and I hope the members of this chamber can agree. Not only is this our consistent use of fossil fuels, it's harmful to the environment. It is unsustainable, not just because of the damage it causes, but because it simply will not last. The point of this motion is to highlight the need for an immediate just transition from work that is dependent on our dwindling oil and gas to renewables and other progressive industries. We've heard today already the job losses that have been caused, and we heard also in the report from the Economy, Energy, Tourism Committee, the jobs, you know, one example where 6,000 jobs have been lost in the platforms, which equates to almost 30,000 jobs in the communities around Scotland. To quote the First Minister, North Sea oil industry is in crisis. Oil prices have fallen to below $30 a barrel, and Petrofac have just announced 100 job losses alongside BP's 600 jobs. All these job losses will impact on workers who are employed in the North Sea oil industry and have a knock-on effect, as Leslie Brennan said, for the families and communities of these workers. From my own region, I have seen the devastation to employees, the families and local communities that the closure of steelworks has caused. The Scottish Government has a responsibility to ensure that such wide-scale job losses and industry closures are in future handled effectively and properly, ensuring that there is a just transition of workers and resources. At their annual address to the STC, highlighted their expectation that 35,000 North Sea oil-related jobs would be lost over the next 5 years. This motion specifically calls on the Scottish Government to work with the trade unions in planning and implementing the transition from a fossil fuel dependent to a fossil free society. The STC further highlighted in their annual address the need for a just transition, a framework created by various trade union organisations which highlights the need and the importance of a transition towards a low carbon and climate resilient economy that maximises the benefits of climate action while minimising the hardship for workers and their communities. The role of the trade unions in this transition is vital. We have a responsibility here in the Scottish Parliament to listen to those we represent. I do not just mean geographically. When we discuss transitions such as these and the workforce of the future, we have a responsibility to listen to the workers and the trade unions. We have a responsibility to hear their voice in all of this. The people best placed to discuss what is best for Scottish workers and the Scottish workforce as those workers themselves. Briefly.
Mark MacDonald.
I wonder then if he would acknowledge the voice of Jake Malloy of the RMT union, who has called for specific measures to support the oil and gas industry, including measures of taxation support from Westminster.
John Wilson.
The Jake Malloy and other unions have supported the just transition policy, and they also support moving away from the dependency that currently exists at the present time on the oil and gas industry and to create sustainable economic policies that actually takes us away from the threat of the ever-fluctuating job security that currently exists in the oil and gas industry.
Final minute.
The redundancies that we've heard of and the actions that are being taken at the present moment clearly show that the workforce who are dependent on the oil and gas industry are in flux. They don't know what's happening from one week to the next. And we heard earlier from Lewis MacDonald the terms and conditions are being eroded and the wages are being cut. I do not deny that the North Sea oil plays an important part in the economy. In fact, it's for that reason that this just transition is needed. Securing our economy, the rights and welfare of workers, the families and local communities, and a future that is unpredictable but clearly not fossil fuel dependent is crucial. Presiding officer, I urge my colleagues in this chamber to join me in supporting this motion. Reject the amendments that have been submitted. This motion supports workers in Scotland, highlights the need for a just transition to alternative work, greater training and skills education, funding to support workers in a future fossil-free Scottish economy. We have an opportunity to show leadership in leading the way forward to get the transition strategy that benefits the workforce and communities of Scotland and putting those in place as quickly as possible.
Thank you. I'm afraid I can only give the next two members up to 6 minutes. Thereafter, I have to reduce to 5 minute speeches. My apologies for that. John Mason to be followed by Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful to speak in this debate and glad that the Greens and Independents have raised it. Can I also congratulate Leslie Brennan on her maiden speech and welcome her both to the Finance and DPLR committees. We'll see if she's smiling quite as much as she's been at the two of them. I hope we can all agree that encouraging renewable energy is absolutely the right way to go. If there is a difference between us, it's probably that the Greens and the Independents want us to go further and faster than we are at present. I shall come...
Jamie McGregor.
On that point, I noticed that on page 83 of the Scottish Government draft budget for 2016-17 is the announcement that they intend to end business rates relief for renewable energy projects unless they are 100% community owned. Is that a way of encouraging renewable energy?
John Mason.
Well, I think, as the member knows, his government has cut this government's budget, so I think there are issues, but I'm more than happy that the Finance Committee should look at that in due course. I shall comment later on some of the issues that I think the Greens and Independents motion arises, but first of all, I'd like to challenge those who oppose the renewable movement, because there are people out there who do that, and in particular people who are opposed to wind farms. Firstly, using wind power is hardly a new phenomenon. People have been doing that for hundreds of years, and the modern turbines are an update of traditional windmills, which I think most people would find acceptable. But I have to say, I also think modern wind farms do look beautiful. They can be an attraction in their own right. And OK, we do not want them covering all of our land, I accept that. But travelling along the M8 from Glasgow to Edinburgh or down the M74 to Carlisle, I consider the scenery is greatly improved by having some of these turbines along the way. Eaglesham Moor was a pretty dull and dreary area in the past, but I consider the Whiteley Wind Farm to be a great attraction, and I'm more keen to go out there for a walk now on the 130 kilometres of trails among the 215 turbines, which can produce some 539 megawatts. Now, at this stage, I would want to say that I think highly of the John Muir Trust and their work to protect wild land. However, I think sometimes their opposition to wind farms has been a little bit over the top. Some of our wild land should be inhabited, and we need to find ways of encouraging people to move back there. However, I would like to comment also on some of the issues which I would have with the Green Independent motion. Firstly, the phrase current over-reliance on fossil fuels. Well, I have to say I'm not totally convinced about that. We have relied on fossil fuels for a very long time, be that coal, oil or gas, and clearly they are not going to last forever, and we need to find alternatives. But I think neither do we need to panic and try and move away from them overnight. There are big challenges to be addressed before we can do that, including how to store electricity better for when we need it. We are seeing improvements in that, and I was impressed recently when a friend took me for a run in his electric car, but it does still have a limited mileage before it needs recharging, and the recharging process itself takes quite a lot of time. On a larger scale, we have pump storage such as at Cruachan, which can effectively store electricity at off-peak times and re-provide it at peak times. But my understanding is that the efficiency there is 75 to 80%, and we lose a bit along the way, so that needs to improve very quickly.
Alison Johnson.
Does the Minister not agree that if we were to invest more wholeheartedly in renewables, and that's at a UK level too, rather than in some of the most expensive electricity on the planet, we might start to be able to invest in getting this technology off the ground faster?
John Mason.
Well, I'm not yet a minister and probably unlikely to be, but I do agree with her that that is a priority for investment, and I would absolutely support any investment we and the universities and others can do in that area. Secondly, the whole question of the North Sea having a shorter lifespan than previously thought, and I actually wonder if that is the case and it might be the opposite. If there are an estimated 22 billion barrels of oil remaining, surely we're not going to walk away from that. And if it's too expensive to get that oil out of the North Sea at the moment, then perhaps once the price goes back up, we can expect to do more of that. Because it should be remembered, as others have said, that the oil price is very volatile. In 1998, it was below $20 and rose in 10 years to more than 100. Thirdly, the whole concept of failing to produce a plan for transition, which I find a very puzzling statement. The whole tone of this government, from what I can hear, is to invest and push on with the transition to renewable energy. There have been disappointments along the way, perhaps with Wave and Tidal, but any new innovation has disappointments along the way.
Final minute.
The tone from Westminster tends to be very negative in comparison to the tone from Holyrood. As with other decisions we need to make in this Parliament, there's a balance to be struck between a variety of objectives. We want a strong economy, and we want a healthy environment, and we need to maximise tax revenues for the taxes that people pay for the public services that we all want to see improved and expanded. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. Claudia Beamish, to be followed by Dennis Robertson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by congratulating Leslie Brennan on her first speech in the Chamber and for her analysis of the climate change imperative and how we can address this together. I am pleased to make a contribution to this debate as well this afternoon. I've long been fighting for future-proofing of our jobs market and welcome the chance to debate it with colleagues. The energy sector faces challenges today that are really indisputable, and my thoughts go out to those thousands affected by job losses, and we must address that issue in an immediate sense. This afternoon, though, I want to speak about planned changes as an opportunity, not something to shy away from. In the face of a changing climate and the commitments in Paris and the traditional fuel industry challenges, the greatest threat to our economy is not to plan for the future. There are fantastic examples of low-carbon jobs in Scotland today. It is important to shout these successes out to give people the confidence to plan for the future. The Scottish Renewables briefing for this debate reminds us that across the UK there are now 21,000 jobs in renewables and £1 billion investment in Scotland in 2014. Looking to the future, education must be at the heart of a strategy for a just transition. By introducing green themes to children in nursery and primary schools, we can inspire future contributions to the low-carbon economy, and this thread should weave throughout every level of education. Will the Scottish Government support programmes such as Heatwise, where pupils used to be involved in designing renewables technologies, and consider putting money into this sort of initiative? And eco-schools should be commended for the robust awareness-raising work that they do. Development of high school courses which focus on new green skills is also vital. The college sector must be highly commended for the role it plays already in providing people with training, skills and opportunities for the new economy. In South Scotland, there is a plethora of opportunities for full-time courses in a wide range of renewable and clean technologies. Theoretical courses combined with practical training facilities and short courses up to upskill those already in work. Borders College has recently launched the UK's first heat recovery system using the local wastewater network, which now provides around 95% of the heat to the Gala campus. And Ayrshire College delivers a wind turbine technician course that is growing in popularity, as well as courses in a huge range of renewables technologies and energy efficiency. The spread of courses in emerging technologies is an extremely positive step. Businesses, small and large, cooperatives and communities and unions are also engaging in the transition, and investing in transferable skills should benefit from continued government support. Unison promotes the recommendations in Green Collination, a TUC Greenpeace document, and GMB has called for a link between vision and action for the green shift, particularly taking into account the needs of workers. Our future economy should also be based on the principle of circularity, reusing materials and keeping them in the system. Innovative product design needs to be supported as the nature of our resources becomes increasingly apparent and the fact that it is not finite. For example, the Ellen MacArthur Foundation recently produced a report on the future of the plastics industry. To make plastics, at present, we do need oil and gas, but it is estimated that plastic production uses the same oil consumption as global aviation. If we continue at this rate, the plastic sector will account for 20% of total oil consumption by 2050. Furthermore, by 2050, the world's oceans are estimated in this report to be expected to contain more plastics as waste than fish by weight. We need to decouple plastics in the longer term from the fossil fuel feedstocks and focus on developing new skills and ideas with government support for a circular economy. We cannot ignore and we must not pretend that change is not vital, but we must plan in a staged and strategic way and take workers along with us in this journey. Scotland has been the birthplace of globally influential innovations throughout the last centuries, and this is an opportunity to again be trailblazers for innovation and creativity in a new economy and society. As Lewis MacDonald said, it is very important that we have a just transition for workers, and we also respect the needs of workers in the fossil fuel industries today, well as planning for the future, so that we have a vibrant energy sector, a wider vibrant economy, and we protect our planet in the future. We cannot delay any longer. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call on Dennis Robertson to be followed by Jean Urquhart.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I too, like my colleagues in the Chamber, congratulate Leslie Brennan in her maiden speech. It took me back probably to my own, and if her knees were shaking just like mine were at the time, I have every sympathy with her. Presiding Officer, the motion before us today is one that is not surprising coming from the Greens, but I'm not sure it acknowledges where we are currently and today. And I think where we are today was reflected in the report from the EET committee, which the convener, Murdo Fraser, mentioned earlier on. And I think it was a well-balanced report because it spoke to the sector.
It spoke to Oil and Gas UK. It spoke with the OGA. It was speaking with the trade unions. It was listening. The committee took on board the fears, the aspirations, but also it took on board the fact that the industry at the moment was in a situation that was unsustainable. One of the things that I always want to say when I come to a debate like this, Presiding Officer, is that as a constituency MSP in Aberdeenshire West, which has a significant number of oil and gas companies and subsea companies as well as renewables, is that it's not just those companies that are out there in the North Sea or those that populate the buildings within West Hill in Aberdeenshire, but it's all those within the supply chain as well. And quite often when we're talking about the industry, we don't give much attention to that supply chain. And I think with the redundancies that we have had within Aberdeen, Aberdeenshire and that wider community, we've got to acknowledge that it's not just the men and women from the platforms, and there's over 6,000, but it is those other workers within the sector. Some have come from the administration side, but some have come from that supply chain too, perhaps maybe up to 30,000. And that's impacted on our hotel industry. It's impacted on many of our small businesses. And when we're addressing the situation within the Northeast at the moment, I think we've got to look at not just the Energy Task Force, but we've got to look at that wider aspect of the impact on that broader community. Now, it is true, Presiding Officer, that it was unsustainable in terms of the number and workforce. And I think Oil and Gas UK and the industry itself reflected this many years ago. In fact, they reflected it before the oil price was in decline. And they were looking towards efficiency then. And they were looking towards more collaboration and cooperation within the industry. Now, that in itself would have probably resulted in some job losses, but certainly not to the extent that we have had now. But I've got a plea to the industry, and this plea is to think carefully about when we get to the level of sustainability and recovery. Think carefully. Do you have, will you have, the skilled workforce to actually extract the oil and gas that we need for the future? There is 22 billion barrels of oil and gas left. And I know this is where, you know, Patrick Harvey and the Greens would move away from the fact that, yeah, they would like to see it left in the ground. But I believe if we're careful, and it's about stewardship, and the Minister said about careful stewardship, we've got to take what is in terms of the resources at the moment. But we are working towards a low-carbon community. And I do regret, sincerely regret, that we don't have the carbon capture at Peterhead. And I think that was wrong of the UK government to walk away from that. Because when we've been looking at the oil and gas industries, we've been trying to encourage them to invest in research and development for the future, in that low-carbon future. And they have been putting money into that. And Shell put an enormous amount of money into the carbon...
30 seconds left.
..into the carbon capture sector. Presiding Officer, there's much more to be said, but what I would like to say in conclusion is that it's about working together, and the sector, the unions, the politicians, whether it be local or here at Holyrood or at Westminster, need to do all we can to sustain the industry that is there, that is at the heart of our economy for now and in the future.
Many thanks. I now call Jean Urquhart to be followed by Rhoda Grant. 5 minute speeches, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Unlike the previous member, Dennis Robertson, I'd suggest that Patrick Harvey's motion does indeed reflect the reality of the present situation regarding jobs in Scotland's new economy. And indeed, if we were not to recognise that the oil is not infinite, then we should be making the plan now. And politicians and governments are generally charged with short-termism
And this seems to me that everything that we've heard today that is not supporting this motion is just that. Of course it's concerned with people's work. Of course it's concerned with the jobs. Of course it's concerned with an industry that has given the United Kingdom government a great deal in income tax. It's also been an industry that has taken a great deal of tax money in investment as well. But if we look at the current situation globally, on the radio this morning, the two economists were in agreement that the Chinese economy is likely to be much worse than is acknowledged by their government, just as the improvement in the United States economy is probably overstated. They've also agreed that the price of a barrel of oil is political. The United States and Saudi Arabia, while setting or agreeing the price, may consider Russia, but they certainly don't consider the Scotland's economy. Quote, below $20 a barrel becomes untenable. There's a glut of oil stocks, albeit that the drop in price is out of our control. Out of our control. And that's part of the problem. If we are to continue to run our industry, renewable industry, in the way that we've run the oil industry, then God help us. And when we say that there's 22 trillion barrels of oil left in the North Sea, then let's look at a long-term plan. There's an example of a small town. And I just want to cite this in the north of Sweden called Kiruna, where 22,000 people live in a town that's built on a mine, and there's subsidence and other problems. So instead of moving everybody, which people didn't want to do, they set about a 100-year plan. A 100-year plan for the people who work there and the people who live there. And over the next 40 years, they will move that town street by street and rebuild the whole thing in this, exactly the same area, but not in the same place and out of danger. And I think this is the kind of planning that Scotland needs to do if we are to make that transitional change. There can be no doubt that we see, and I represent the Highlands and Islands, that the Highlands and Islands is seen as a kind of, you know, powerhouse. Alex Salmond himself said that the Pentland Firth could be seen as a kind of potential Saudi Arabia in terms of energy. But let's look at some of the reality of what we've done so far with renewable energy. We've built wind farms largely to the benefit of private companies and private landowners. There've been small community benefit, and I mean small, very small community benefit, and very selective. Yes, okay.
Mark MacDonald.
The member would have heard me highlight in my speech that a target that was set for community renewables for 2020 was achieved in 2015. That surely demonstrates that the Scottish Government is showing support and leadership to community renewable schemes.
Thank you, Jean. I'll cut you now in your last minute.
Thank you very much. I don't doubt that there are some, and I can cite very good examples of community-owned energy schemes, but we have to be realistic that the targets are not being met by community renewables. And the economic driver of renewables is not in local communities. But I think what we have to see is a plan for a low-carbon economy, and it's clearly long overdue. In Paris, the Minister for Climate Change and our First Minister declared that they would embed in our budget funding for renewables and to deal with climate change. Now, nobody in the last few months can be unaware of the damage that climate change is. It's not something that's going to happen. It's something that's happening now.
You have to close, I'm afraid.
It's the best time to plant a tree was 30 years ago, and the second best time is today. I think we support this motion and start our 100-year plan today. Thank you.
Thank you. Now call Rhoda Grant, Joan McAlpine. Strict 5 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I, like others, congratulate Leslie Brennan on her first speech. It was an excellent speech in a very important debate. Presiding officer, oil and gas jobs are not only concentrated in Aberdeen. Many of my constituents through the Highlands and Islands are dependent on these jobs, travelling from as far away as the Western Isles to go offshore. And indeed, those jobs are based in some of our more remote and small communities, and the loss of those jobs will have a knock-on effect to the economies of those already fragile communities. Shetland has an economy largely based around oil and gas, and a turn down in the industry will have an enormous impact on them. This emphasises, if we need reminding, the global economy that we live in. Decisions taken halfway around the world have catastrophic impacts on our constituents at home. But can I firstly make a plea? Yes, margins are tight in the oil and gas industry. Yes, cuts are being made. However, if these cuts lead to cuts in safety in the industry, it's totally unacceptable. Changes in shift patterns are dangerous in themselves. Forcing people to work 3 weeks without a break is unsafe. You need a workforce that's rested and switched on. Otherwise, they will make mistakes, and these shift patterns will also impact on their home life, their relationships, and their families. When dealing with substances as volatile as oil and gas, no corners can be cut with regard to safety. We cannot simply write off an industry without consideration of the workforce and their future. We know indeed that reserves will run out, but we need to plan the managed withdrawal from those energy supplies. And it's sad to say, I see no planning going on. There are, of course, opportunities with regard to renewables, and onshore renewables have been developed on the mainland and in some cases have provided a valuable income stream for communities. However, there are missed opportunities in making more of these developments. Communities which are wholly owned by the public and by their members would have had much better return if they had been able to manage those developments in their entirety. Community-owned estates would have been able to develop huge income streams going forward. Some of them luckily have, but not that many. But there are many areas that have not enjoyed these benefits at all. Without an interconnector, the Western Isles cannot develop their full potential of renewable energy, either on or offshore. Given the economic situation in these areas, this investment would be a game changer, not only in income, but the jobs created and the spin-off investment of that wealth by community landowners investing in jobs and diversification in their own communities. The waters in the north and west of Scotland are the most energetic in Europe. The ability to harness this energy would bring much needed benefits in jobs and investment, and also provide a source of dependable renewable energy to the whole country. But sadly, the investment in wave and tidal energy has been pulled back, and we've seen developers go out of business or indeed cut their research and development in this area. We talked about the potential for years, but the Scottish Government must invest in research and development because the market is failing to do so. In Orkney, we have a great deal of expertise. We need to keep those people in the area and working on the innovative technology that can capture wave and tidal energy. If we let this go, we'll lose that industry to Scotland because the expertise will be snapped up elsewhere. And if this happens, we'll end up buying in from other countries the wherewithal to extract our natural resources. This happened with onshore wind. We can't afford to let it happen with wave and tidal as well. We need to ensure that there's sufficient interconnector capacity from the islands back to the mainland to allow us to benefit from this energy when it's available. In the Highlands and Islands, we also have the highest level of fuel poverty in Scotland. And for the most part, that's because we're off gas grid, meaning alternatives are very expensive. We need a step change in insulation, of course, but we also need people to be able to install micro renewables. And that would cut the cost of energy, removing them from fuel poverty, but also create jobs in these areas, because people in fuel poverty can't really invest in micro renewables in their own homes. They need support and they need help in developing these alternatives. It would also, as I said, create jobs in small businesses. But some of those renewable jobs seldom go to small businesses because of the bureaucracy involved in registration of installers.
You must close.
The registration needs to be done in a way that ensures that small businesses benefit. Presiding officer, we need a clear policy going forward. We need to prepare for a time we no longer have oil and gas, and we need to manage that transition.
Thank you. My apologies for the lack of time. Joan McAlpine, maximum 5 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I have sympathy for the points Patrick Harvey makes and the consistency of his position, but he is in a difficult position with regards to timing. I agree that there are transferable skills between the oil and gas industry and the renewable industry, obviously in engineering, fabrication, financing, and the myriad of skills that cascade down the supply chain into the wider economy. However, just at the time when oil workers could be looking at alternative careers in renewable energy, that sector is being undermined catastrophically by the policies of the UK government. My colleague Mark MacDonald pointed to the briefing from Scottish Renewables, which commended the leadership of the Scottish Government in promoting renewables. But more of that briefing is taken up by what it calls the barriers to future growth emanating from the policies of the UK government. To quote the report, cuts to and closures of support schemes at UK level have significant questions about the future development of renewable energy. It's worth reminding ourselves of the extent of these cuts. They include the renewable obligation, the main driver of growth in renewable capacity since 2002. The UK Secretary of State for Energy and Climate Change has announced that the renewable obligation would close to onshore wind a year earlier than expected, on the 31st of March this year. And Contracts for Difference, the only policy lever to support large-scale green generation, there's currently no certainty over the budget for or timescales of the next allocation of Contracts for Difference at present. And Scottish Renewables says, I'm sorry, I have no time, says that this delay could fatally undermine the timeline for the projects in Scotland's main island groups and raises serious questions about whether the proposed offshore wind projects can make the 2020 deadline. The UK government has also made it clear that it will not allocate future subsidy to offshore wind, as I've said, and it will not form part of the next CFD allocation. Our Energy Committee has heard how Contracts for Difference are unsuitable for energy storage projects, hence holding up major pump storage initiatives and, of course, the development of interesting alternative storage technologies. There's also uncertainty around the renewable heat incentive, which, although it is continuing, is having its budget reduced, and we've still to hear exactly how it's planned to work in future. This affects small businesses all over Scotland who have invested in training staff to install the devices that enable renewable heat. And to that we should add, of course, as others have, the abandoning of the carbon capture project. So even if we could effect a smooth transition between oil and gas and renewables, I believe that now is not the time to be rushing into things. It might give a sense of moral superiority to those advocating a radical and abrupt change of direction, but it does not at this point offer workers the certainty they need to make that change. During our evidence gathering session in committee, we looked at the Aberdeen and Grampian Chamber of Commerce oil and gas survey, which was conducted in collaboration with Strathclyde University. Obviously, there were aspects of it that which were pessimistic, but there were positives. They said, for example, for individuals, there were still jobs available. For companies, labour market conditions had eased and they were finding it easier to recruit and retain core staff. And over the next 3 years, employment growth is expected by contractors. And for that reason, we need to be careful, too, about being too hasty at moving towards decommissioning. To quote the same report, Ústeinn Vass, the Bond Dickinson oil and gas legal expert, made a very vivid comment. He said, a significant short-term increase in decommissioning activity will inevitably herald a more rapid decline in offshore exploration and production, since the industry will feed on the body of infrastructure which supports it. In effect, the industry will be eating away at its own bones.
Final I think
minute. That is a very vivid illustration of what we face, and to go down that road is far too risky in moving away from what is obviously an important job creator in Scotland. Thank you.
Many thanks. That then brings us to the closing speeches. and I call on Mary Scanlon. 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I just register an interest? My son is a civil engineer working in the wind farm industry. And can I just say to John Mason that I'm not against wind farms, but I do like them to be in the right place. And can I thirdly congratulate Leslie Brennan, another feisty woman from Dundee, on her contribution to this debate, and we look forward to working with her in future. I would like to thank the Greens and Independents for selecting this topic for debate today. It took me back to when I left school in Montrose in the 1960s. There was no North Sea oil industry then, and the opportunities for young people were very different to those of today. I cast my mind back to the day I left school, and my three options were bus conductor, selling cakes in the local Frost Bakers, or a weaver in Peyton's Mill, Jute Mill in Montrose. And that's very different to what's on offer today, thankfully. I agree with Sir Ian Wood when he said there are generations out there who have always taken the oil industry for granted, and who've become very dependent on the oil and gas industry, and that this way of thinking needs to change, pointing to the way forward positively, with the right kind of plan, the right kind of people, working with local authorities, the Scottish and the UK governments. And I think many contributions today have been positive rather than negative in looking forward, because I certainly don't see the oil and gas industry in the past tense. I'm also pleased to note that there is more realism and honesty about North Sea oil revenue, and that the SNP and Greens are not claiming unrealistic oil revenues for decades to come and decrying anyone who dared to think or state differently. When OBR forecast oil revenues of £3.3 billion for 2016-17 during the referendum campaign, they were absolutely ridiculed. But today it is a fact that Brent crude is $28 a barrel, over $100 lower than the SNP forecasts for economic independence. And given the lifting of sanctions from Iran, there is no doubt that this will bring more oil to the market, and it will affect future predictions on the price. But in the early days of North Sea oil contraction, many thought this would be an industry for 25 to 30 years. The high oil price has allowed many of the marginal fields to be exploited, given that that price covered the increased costs of extraction. And now that some of the rigs are coming to the end of their working life, and more than a third are over 30 years old, the costs are increasing and revenue decreasing, so it is an opportune time to have this debate. But where I do agree with Patrick Harvey is undoubtedly on the opportunities for decommissioning. And we have been slow off the mark to ensure our fair share of decommissioning comes to Scotland. Many of the earlier projects went to Norway and they went to the northeast of England. And whilst I welcome the investment into the infrastructure in Lerwick, Scotland still needs, as Rhoda Grant said, to ensure that these opportunities are available to Scottish yards and Scottish workers. Scotland and the UK were pioneers of North Sea oil exploration, and we continue to export this expertise with oil workers trained in Scotland working around the globe. So we now have the potential opportunity to become a global leader in decommissioning skills, skills which will also be needed around the world. With £17 billion forecast to be spent on scrapping 79 platforms and plugging 1,200 wells over the next 10 years, and a decommissioning budget of £47 billion up to 2050, this should be seen as an opportunity for developing skills and jobs. As Murdo Fraser said, we very much welcome the Energy Jobs Task Force announced a year ago, and we hope that this will address the skill shortages elsewhere in our workforce. But I do think that we should be aware of the wage differences between the North Sea and working on a wind farm. The average salary in the North Sea is £64,000, compared to the average salary for a technician building a wind farm of £25,000. And if you get a 2-year contract of work on a wind farm, you're very lucky, and you've got to wonder about what comes next. But in the long term, the only jobs on the wind farms are for routine maintenance or call-out. if any problems arise. And another point worth making that Patrick Harvey should also be aware of, 70% of the cost of any wind farm in Scotland goes out of the country to pay for the turbines and the towers.
Final minute.
So I do congratulate the Energy, Enterprise and Tourism Committee. I think this is an excellent report. I appreciate it's short. I appreciate it's a snapshot in time. But I think it's an excellent contribution going forward. Thank you.
Many thanks. And I now call on Jackie Bailey. Up to 6 minutes, please, Ms Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and like others, could I start by commending Leslie Brennan on her maiden speech. She pointed out that growth is indeed sluggish. Our rate of growth is also slower than the rest of the UK. Unemployment is in percentage terms greater than the rest of the UK, and our employment growth is not as fast. The jobs we're generating tend to be low-paid, temporary and part-time. Because it is in that context that Lewis MacDonald was absolutely right to talk about the importance of oil. Not a bonus, not an optional extra, but central to our economy and accounting for billions, including something like 200,000 jobs and well-paid jobs at that. Estimates of oil at $113 a barrel in the white paper do appear a distant memory when you set that against the price of a barrel of oil today at $28 a barrel. So the world has changed. It's down 18% since even the new year, down a staggering 70% in 18 months. We know that global oil demand ground to a halt in November. It fell in December for the first time in 13 months. And the big oil producers, the Saudis, are not about to change their policy. So a range of expert industry forecasters have predicted even lower prices coming in the months ahead. Whether it's Barclays revising their estimates downwards or indeed Morgan Stanley joining that growing number of voices warning that oil prices could slide down to $20 a barrel. It is devastating. It's devastating not just for our public finances or indeed for the economy. It's devastating for jobs, in particular in the northeast and across Scotland. And the Scottish Government need, with all due respect, to recognise the seriousness of the problem and the fact that it has deepened dramatically in a very short space of time. Where I absolutely agree is that we should be doing all we can to sustain this important industry, which is why from the very start, Labour has been calling for regular oil and gas bulletins, because you know, you need to understand what is happening in a minute, and specifically the impact on jobs and the economy, because that helps in ensuring that the action you take is right. Happy to
Mark MacDonald.
I welcome the member's statement that everything that can be done should be done. Does she agree then that exploration tax credits, which I have said would not just help in terms of the companies themselves, but also the supply chain, would be welcome and is something that the Chancellor should bring forward in his budget?
Jackie Bailey.
Okay, it strikes me there's no point in having a tax credit if you're not actually paying tax, but we would support any effort to invest in exploration, and we would wish to do so through the OGA because we think they know how best to do it. Can I say to you as well, the oil used to account for about 13% of Scottish GDP. Regretfully, that's not the case now. Thousands of jobs have already been lost. Oil and Gas UK suggests something like 65,000 direct and indirect jobs. BP, as we've heard from many members around the chamber, cutting 4,000 jobs globally, 600 from the North Sea. Petrofarc said 160 UK jobs. We could have a roll call of oil companies, but it's also their supply chain as well. And it's businesses in the North East, businesses across Scotland. The FSB told us this week that confidence amongst small businesses was at its lowest level for 3 years, specifically because of fears about an oil industry crisis. So small local suppliers just as affected. Our focus needs to be as well on those individuals who've already lost their jobs, helping them into alternative employment, retaining their skills, ensuring that our economy can benefit from their knowledge in future will be important. And I listened carefully to the Minister. And of course, we support the positive work in the oil and gas industry, making the industry more efficient, working with the supply chain and indeed the workforce. And we welcome the Energy Jobs Task Force. but it last reported in September. We don't know how many people have been helped into other jobs or helped into retraining because the government don't know. What we do know as a result of the newspaper's FOIs is that neither the First Minister or indeed any other minister, including the one here today, met with the chair of the task force since June. Now, that's hugely disappointing. I expected a greater sense of urgency. So we need a new oil and gas bulletin. In fact, we need a regular one. The last one was published in June on the very last day of term. When will we see that update? And can the minister promise to publish before Parliament rises in March? Others have made the case for renewables, presiding officer. I won't repeat some of their arguments. Suffice to say, I believe we need a mixed energy supply. And of course, we will need to consider decommissioning and transition in due course. But there is still much opportunity in the North Sea. I think it was Murdo Fraser that mentioned BIFAB. Here is a good example of a company that does both decommissioning and offshore wind fabrication, which I commend to the government. Presiding officer, there are those that say that this isn't a problem, it's all wonderful. That's a degree of complacency that fails to understand the challenge to the economy. There are those that say we should decommission everything now, and I think that misses the potential of what lies in the North Sea. And frankly, to those that say let's devolve it, I simply fail to understand what they are talking about and find it, frankly, quite bizarre. We should be exploiting all of the opportunities before us. In closing, presiding officer, we won't be supporting the SNP amendment because it preempts the Labour amendment, but also because we believe the Scottish Government can do more. They can urgently review the impact on jobs and support for the industry, and perhaps they would do so and start by publishing an updated oil and gas bulletin.
Thank you very much. And I call on Fergus Ewing. 8 minutes, please, Minister.
I think Leslie Brennan finished on a very good point, namely that this Parliament is a place where we together can work together for the people of Scotland. So I welcome her maiden contribution in this chamber. And we can maximise, by working together, the opportunities we have in Scotland to create a secure and a resilient energy mix. Scotland has set world-leading targets that provide a strong contribution to required global emission reductions. We are on track to meet and exceed our 2020 target for a 42% reduction in emissions. Renewable energy is one of our most important industries, creating jobs and investment opportunities whilst delivering secure, low-carbon and cost-effective energy supplies. Indeed, in the last 10 years, renewable electricity output has more than doubled and now supplies half of the electricity consumed in Scotland, beating our target by, I think, a year, our provisional target. And we are also leading the way across the UK in how we support local and community ownership of renewable energy, having met our 2020 target of 500 megawatts of community and locally owned renewable generation capacity 5 years early. But we've got much more work to do. Of course, we accept that. Just today, earlier today, I met Star Refrigeration, who are a leading company in the field of renewable heat through heat pumps. They've delivered projects in places like Drammen in Norway through companies such as SunAmp, who are world leaders in providing methods of storage of electricity. We do need more storage generally, a point that was made by a number of speakers, pump storage, but also at distribution and at household level. That's extremely important. We need, as Rhoda Grant pointed out, the islands to be connected. And this, I've said, presiding officer, is my top priority. Not a, but the top priority. That's why I've been working with the UK government, first with Ed Davey and now with Amber Rudd, to try to achieve that. And I'm still, as an optimist, hopeful that we may get there. And that would achieve great things for the islands for the reasons that have been stated. But I do want to say a little bit about some of the measures. Murdo Fraser said that in response to, points from Mark MacDonald about the need for measures to encourage exploration, that tax is not something that the industry has focused on or mentioned greatly. I think it's true to say that it's perhaps not the main focus of many companies that are focused on survival, quite frankly. Let's not beat about the bush. I recognise that. But at the same time, there are teams of people in Aberdeen whose work is almost entirely based on exploration. Now, if there is no work for them to do, the risk is that we lose these skills. That was the point Dennis Robertson rightly made. If we lose skills of people because there's no work for them to do, then we may not be able to bring them back, a point well made by Mr. Robertson. It is fair to say, I think, that you know, Faroe Petroleum drilled several wells, four, I think, in the Norwegian sector this year. That's because Norway offers 7-8% exploration tax credit measures. So you get 4 for 1. It's like going into Tesco and you get four for the price of one from Asda. So plainly, that is an important measure. I'd like specifically to praise all right.
Mark MacDonald.
I wonder if the Minister also agrees that the impact on the supply chain of exploration is extremely important. As I cited, one supply company who told me that for every rig that is out performing exploration is worth £250,000 to that company.
Minister.
Absolutely right. And also the point is that the prices of hiring rigs and exploration gear are not expensive at the moment because of supply and demand, and therefore it's a great time. I would want to specifically to say that we work very closely with Oil and Gas UK, with Subsea UK, with the Oil and Gas Authority. Andy Samuel is doing a great job. I work very closely with him. I think that's really accepted, I think, by all main parties anyway that support the oil and gas industry. And they're doing work to encourage new fields such as Lancaster or Bentley, small pools, late life extension, a technology centre. We've set up OGIC, which is funded to the tune of several million pounds, which does great work. There are lots of positives going on. Apache and Taka have made recent discoveries. Lewis MacDonald.
Lewis MacDonald.
I'm very grateful to the Minister. Will he agree with me that the Oil and Gas Authority directly spending money on exploration, as it spent £20 million on that in recent months, is the most effective way to enable the kind of exploration we want to see offshore?
Minister.
Well, I think it's effective, but I would doubt that it's the most effective, and there's no sign that the UK is going to repeat that £20 million in this year's budget. It was good work. We supported it. And incidentally, I think Scottish universities at postgrad level can be put to use to analyse the data from that seismic work. I know they can, and I've encouraged Andy Samuel to do just that for Scottish universities. But I do think that needs to be supplemented, so I agree with some of that. In the time I have left, I do think it would be useful, really, despite the ideological divide between the authors of this debate and almost all of the rest of us, to answer a fairly simple question. I mentioned in my opening speech that Clare, Kraken, Mariner, ETAP, Quad, Culzean, they're all going ahead. The simple question is this: do the Greens support those projects going ahead, or are they saying that for their analysis, they think those projects should be scrapped? I'd be very interested to know if they will answer that question directly.
Minister wants to give way.
Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful for the opportunity. We have consistently, and include published proposals during the referendum campaign under the auspices of the Green Yes campaign, making it clear that the focus must shift from maximum extraction to maximum revenue generation in the shorter term, so that we invest the revenue, as Norway, for example, gets far more revenue per barrel of oil than the UK does, invest the revenue in the transition. Unless we do that, then we're going to be left high and dry when the transition arrives, whether we like it or not.
Well, if that was the answer to my question, then I think everyone else will be as mystified as I am. I think the truth is, as I close, presiding officer, is that the Greens, for their reasons, do want to essentially shut down the oil and gas industry. And if they don't, they can make clear whether or not they think that these new projects, which will sustain tens of thousands of jobs and which are great news for Scotland, should or should not go ahead. But I do welcome the opportunity to have this debate today. And for my part, working with David Mundell, whom I meet next Thursday, with the oil and gas industry, visiting Aberdeen, as I shall be next Monday and Tuesday, we will continue to demonstrate our support for the industry, not just by words, but by deeds, and do everything we possibly can, working with others and all parties, to help people through these times of the most severe challenges the industry arguably has ever faced, and do absolutely everything within our power, continue to do so, to help those people continue in work and doing such a great job for this country.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Alison Johnson. To wind up the debate, please, 10 minutes, Ms Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start by thanking Leslie Brennan for choosing to make her first contribution to Parliament in this debate. Leslie Brennan said that at the heart of this motion is the economy, and of course, at the heart of the economy are people. And this debate is about securing a prosperous future for Scotland. And to do that, we need to think ahead of the game, to be open to change and be bold in our ambition for what we can achieve. And of course, bold ambitions are admirable, but they'll come to nothing without a serious and credible plan. We know that we're over-reliant on fossil fuels, with all the financial, social and environmental risks that entails. Patrick Harvey, John Wilson and Jean Urquhart have set out those risks well. Claudia Beamish spoke well of the opportunities that a low-carbon economy can bring. And all colleagues have focused rightly on job losses, though we disagree on how best to secure those jobs in the long term. We know that the North Sea oil and gas industry... I'd like to make some progress. We know that the North Sea oil and gas industry is vitally important, but it can't sustain the jobs it currently does forever. And today's job loss situation brings this into sharp focus. We must help people left out of work. And it would be a reckless gamble on people's jobs not to plan alternatives. A transition which secures people's jobs and livelihoods and guarantees jobs in the new economy. Sandra White spoke of the need to involve workers. Absolutely. But let's not have constant post-redundancy action for those who work in oil and gas, but be proactive, ensuring job matching and reskilling now. And we need a prosperous economy to drive investment into low-carbon jobs, because nobody benefits from economic turbulence and unemployment. The Scottish Greens' new economy report on what a transition could look like is clear that any response to climate change must be a job creator and a community rebuilder. Built on conservative estimates of the jobs required for an ambitious energy transition, the report shows how the new economy can employ thousands more than the old. Our 200,000 estimate is for direct jobs, high-paid, high-skilled jobs. We did not count so-called induced jobs, though these are a vital part of the picture too, as Dennis Robertson and other colleagues have highlighted. And I agree too with Dennis Robertson that we must all work together for a sustainable future. The Scottish Parliament can lead, but it can't do this alone. John Wilson highlighted the role of the trade unions in a just transition. And it's clear that to deliver the low-carbon jobs and infrastructure we need will require a whole-scale change of UK economic policy away from austerity towards investment. Today's debate showed that there is some consensus on the need for change. Lewis MacDonald was right to say that a transition driven by crisis would not be just, and our motion recognises this. But yet the big question remains. We know that we can't burn even half the world's fossil fuel reserves if we are to have a chance at avoiding catastrophic climate change, but every other party in this chamber advocates ploughing on. Several members have spoken of the need for further exploration. And the Bank of England warns of repricing risks. What this means is the risk that oil companies are holding billions of pounds of stranded assets and are significantly overvalued as a result. Some national pension schemes are beginning to recognise this result, this potential, and are divesting from fossil fuels now. They've already done so. There are very big...
Minister?
I mean, I would be grateful if Alison Johnson could answer the question that Mr Harvey didn't answer, namely, do the Greens favour that the projects I mentioned, the new projects, should go ahead or not?
Alison Johnson?
I think Mr Harvey answered that question very fully. The Greens are not suggesting for a second that the oil industry should cease tomorrow. We are speaking on a just transition, one that will protect the thousands of jobs that have been lost and will continue to be lost in this industry while the Scottish Government does not come forward with a credible plan. As I was saying, there are very big systemic risks with very real-world consequences for people, like those job losses, which other parties are intent on blindly ignoring. A healthy economy is vital for jobs, prosperity and for investment in a low-carbon economy. A disordered reduction in the fossil fuel industry is in no one's interests. We need to plan for it. The SNP government claim that they are planning for the transition, and credit where it's due. The Scottish Government has made considerable efforts to expand renewables, but I think it's just as fair to say they are not passionately committed to reducing the burning of fossil fuels. On Monday in Westminster, Green MP Caroline Lucas spoke up again against a UK government which seems intent on pulling the rug from the renewables industry and throwing the crown jewels at Hinkley Point C nuclear reactor. In this debate, she spoke of the entrepreneurs' call to climate action, a joint statement from 121 CEOs with international operations. And they said that 100% fossil-free solutions already exist, as opposed to a slightly better version of an already existing polluting alternative. So businesses, in many cases, are ahead of politicians. Joan McAlpine spoke of the need for greater devolved powers, and I agree. But if others are developing the skills in decommissioning, it's really important that we do that too. Think of all the jobs that will exist in decommissioning, the opportunities there. If we're not decommissioning, other countries will be decommissioning on our behalf. Yes?
I'm grateful to the member for taking the question on the point. Does the member agree with me then that we should try and ensure that our young workforce of the future is given the diverse skills that they can work in either industry, whether it be continuing the oil and gas or indeed the renewables, such as AIS in West Hill and Aberdeen?
Alison Johnson.
I certainly think that we should be skilling our young workforce as well as we possibly can, but it's certainly the case that renewables has a far greater, more sustainable future ahead of us, as is demonstrated by what's happening in the oil and gas industry at the moment. Murdo Fraser and the Minister demonstrated that there's no recognition of the real-world risk that Mark Carney tries to get us to recognise. That's the need for a reduction in fossil fuels coupled with an increase in low-carbon jobs, both sides of the same coin. Half our electricity now comes from renewables. We're halfway to the 100% target, and that is great progress. But there's so many more opportunities. Only 15% of total energy needs were met by renewables in 2015. And Scottish renewables predict that that will rise to 28% by 2020. And to keep us on the right track, they propose a 50% renewable target for 2030. To grow our renewables output, we need to harness the skills and experience of those currently working in the North Sea. Subsea engineers, machine operators, helicopter pilots, surveyors, welders and many others to build and maintain offshore energy infrastructure. We need thousands of workers to make the transition to a healthy, sustainable and climate-safe society and economy, and we've got the skills and expertise to do it. In 2014, the Department for Business, Innovation and Skills published a report comparing the supply chain needed for offshore wind to existing industries and supply chains. There are many synergies. There's high synergies for surveys, subsea array cables for wind farm design, building substations, monopole foundations, and so on. For 75% of the offshore wind supply chain, there's existing expertise in the oil industry that has been applied to wind. What this means is that people directly and indirectly employed by North Sea Oil are extremely well placed to build Scotland's offshore renewable infrastructure. We don't have all the skills for the transition, but our existing industries give us an incredible kickstart. But we need to plan and invest to deliver the rest. And we need that massive increase in apprenticeships coupled with a focus on breaking down the gender segregation, which is so evident in our modern apprenticeships. Skills gaps hinder progress. Even in London, they were stymied when they tried to increase building retrofitting by a lack of workers with appropriate skills. But the oil and renewable industries already face a shortage of skilled offshore workers. Without a good depth of skills and companies able to deliver infrastructure, prices can shoot up. And this is already a concern when we look at flood defence mechanisms in this country.
None of this means an end for oil and gas in Scotland. We have to adapt, but we've got no doubt that the North Sea and its oil and gas still has an important role to play in our economic future. From school rulers to roofing tiles, from pipes to paint, from ink to contact lenses, the raw materials come from the North Sea. Vitally important ingredients for medicines are found here too. Surely we should seek to lengthen the longevity of uses like this. Presiding officer, in 20 years' time, people may look back and wonder why we burnt such valuable, irreplaceable resources like oil and gas long after we became aware of alternatives. Scotland can deliver a safer and more stable economy with stronger communities and secure employment. We can do this by securing jobs today, planning the transition and being bold in our ambition for jobs of tomorrow. I commend the Green motion. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on jobs in Scotland. A point of order, Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm sorry for not raising this to your attention in advance. You frequently remind members who've taken part in debates that they should be present in the chamber, not just present, but present to listen to the closing speeches. I wonder if that principle also applies to a minister representing the government in this debate today who chose to spend time wandering about the back of the chamber during both the opening and the closing speeches from the party bringing the debate.
Minister, a point of order.
I do, in response to that judgment, point out I have been in the chamber for one comfort break throughout the whole debate, and I've consulted with civil servants at the back intermittently, and I've listened to all members, I hope, with courtesy and respect.
As I have not been present for most of the day myself, then I have no further comment to make on it. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 15370 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 15370.
Moved.
No member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the chamber. The question is that motion number 15370 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 15368 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick setting out on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting at a stage one timetable. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 15368.
Moved.
No members asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the chamber. The question is that motion number 15368 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 15369. In the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a stage two timetable, any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 15369.
Moved.
No member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the chamber. The question is that motion number 15369, in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of four Parliamentary Bureau motions. I'd ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motions number 15373 to 15375 on approval of SSIs en bloc and motion number 15372 on substitution on committees.
Moved en bloc.
The questions on these motions will be put at decision time, to which we now come. There are six questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is amendment number 15356.2.1 in the name of Murdo Fraser, which seeks to amend amendment number 15356.2 in the name of Fergus Ewing on jobs in Scotland's new economy be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament's not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 15356.2.1 in the name of Murdo Fraser is as follows. Yes, 12. No, 70. There were 29 abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. Can I now remind members that if the amendment in the name of Fergus Ewing is agreed, the amendment in the name of Lewis MacDonald falls. So, the next question is amendment number 15356.2 in the name of Fergus Ewing, which seeks to amend motion number 15356 in the name of Patrick Harvey on jobs in Scotland's new economy be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 15356.2 in the name of Fergus Ewing is yes 76, no 35. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed to, and the amendment in the name of Lewis MacDonald falls. The next question is that motion number 15356 in the name of Patrick Harvey as amended on jobs in Scotland's new economy be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion number 15356 in the name of Patrick Harvey as amended is as follows. Yes, 104. No, 6. There were no abstentions. The motion as amended is therefore agreed to. I propose to ask a single question on motions number 15373 to 15375 on approval of SFSIs. If any member objects to a single question being put, please say so now. No member has objected to a single question being put. Therefore, the question is that motions number 15373 to 15375 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on approval of SSIs be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 15372 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on substitution on committees be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We now move to members' business. Members who leave the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.